Hey, what's up guys? Today I'll show you a horror thriller film, Last Shift. Spoiler ahead, watch out and take care. The movie begins with the rookie's mother calling her before starting her first shift in a police station. Her mother is worried that she will get in harm's way, but the rookie quickly assures her that she is perfectly safe. She ends the call and walks into the Sanford police station. The station appears to be deserted. The rookie walks along the hallway, trying to find if there's anyone else there. Suddenly, an angry and shouting man appears at the other end of the hallway. The rookie stops in her tracks, and the man notices her. She quickly turns around and walks away, but the man catches up to her. She notices that the man is a cop. He introduces himself as the sergeant, her commanding officer. The sergeant tells the rookie that the station is in the process of transferring to a new location, and so she is being tasked to man the very last shift at the old station tonight. During this shift, she will be alone, as all emergency calls will be rerouted to the new station. The sergeant also informs her that his address and phone number are written on a slip of paper on the wall if she needs to contact him. The sergeant continues the tour and leads the rookie to the evidence room. He tells her that the hazmat team is due to collect the remaining evidence for disposal between 10 p.m. and 4 a.m., and she has to wait for them and oversee the collection. The rookie is not allowed to leave the station for any reason whatsoever. The sergeant hands her the keys and exits the station. The rookie spends her time reading a book, but there are only so many pages she can flip through before she starts getting sleepy. Outside the waiting room, an overhead light starts to flicker. She then hears the phone ring. She quickly walks back into the room and picks up the phone. On the other end of the line is a hysterical girl calling for help. The girl tells her that she thinks her companions are dead. The rookie tries to calm her down and get the address from her, so she can send a unit to their location, but the call disconnects suddenly. She then calls the dispatcher at the new station to report the distress call. The dispatcher assures her that all calls are being rerouted, but the dispatcher will address the issue from his end. Suddenly, the rookie hears a door slam from somewhere inside the station. She investigates it, but finds no other person in the building. Shrugging it off, she sits down and eats a sandwich. While chewing, she finds a strand of long dark hair inside her mouth. Being disgusted, she vomits. She then hears someone banging on the front door of the station. She checks it out, but again finds no one outside. However, when she turns to go back inside, there is a homeless man already inside. He has unkempt clothes and long, greasy hair. To her surprise, he starts pouring his stink water on the floor. All this time, the homeless man says nothing. She has to kick his smelly ass out of the station. While washing her hands, the rookie hears pipes mysteriously creaking. She finds a pair of old boots and leaves them outside the door for the homeless man. When she returns, she notices that groans are coming from the men's restroom. She steps inside and sees a dark and smelly liquid splatter all over the restroom, even making its way to the toilets and mirrors. The rookie walks into the locker room and sees a picture tucked inside one of the cubbies. It's of an older man in police uniform, carrying a young girl on his shoulders. She takes a closer look at the picture, and both grief and joy show in her face. She tenderly touches the picture and is about to take it, but she decides to just put it back where she found it. The people in the picture must be her and her father, taken years ago when he was still alive. The phone rings, and it's the girl calling again. She whispers that someone is bringing her to a ranch. She says she hears pigs and quickly disconnects the call because her kidnappers might hear. Right after, the phone rings again, but this time, it's one of the cleaners from the hazmat team. The cleaner informs the rookie that they're running a little late, but he'll call her again if things change. The rookie contacts the station dispatcher again, and he tells her that the girl is probably calling the old station phone number directly. She hears something clattering in the evidence room. Inside, she sees file cabinets being upturned. She radios the station for backup. An old radio starts to blare a song. The lights turn off, and she whips out her flashlight. She is afraid, but she tries to be brave. A box tumbles near her feet, and she sees the homeless man rummaging through the case files. The rookie incapacitates him using her baton and quickly handcuffs the homeless man. She drags him inside the interrogation room, but the doors suddenly slam shut, and the lights turn off again. The man struggles against her, and the rookie tases the homeless man. The rookie tries to open the door, then sees a bloody face outside the window. Terrified, she scampers back and loses her flashlight. In the darkness, she hears the homeless man's heavy breathing. She warns him not to make any sudden moves. Someone picks up the flashlight and points it at the rookie. than to the unmoving body of the homeless man on the other side of the room. The rookie hears more whispers from the apparitions in the room. Then, the flashlight is switched off. The lights turn back on, and for a split second, the rookie sees more people with bloody faces around the room, scaring her out of her shit. Meanwhile, the rookie finds outside the station a blonde woman carrying two heavy hormone mountains, but sucking the light cigarette. She tells the rookie that she can't loiter around the premises. The blonde woman shares that she is in the station the same night that the cult is being arrested for kidnapping and killing young girls. The rookie scoffs at the other's story, telling her that that cult died on the scene, and her father was one of the arresting officers. The blonde woman contradicts this story and says that they are being arrested and put in the cell next to hers. But the next morning, the police discovered that the cult had killed themselves. Back inside, the rookie finds a television set playing the interview tapes of the arrested cult members. The cult leader and his female followers reveal that they worship the devil and carry out these atrocities in his name. In the tape, the cult leader promises that he will come back and take everything they hold dear. The tape ends, and out of nowhere comes a swivel chair that knocks the rookie to the ground. The phone rings again, and this time, the girl is crying. She tells the rookie that they murdered the girls she stayed with, and they kept singing while doing it. It is the same song that the rookie had heard earlier. She gives her last name and age before the call gets disconnected again. The rookie rings the dispatcher and shares her suspicions that the remaining cult members continue the previous murder spree. Another officer comes to check up on her. At first, she thinks the officer has been pulling pranks on her, but he explains that he has no idea what she's talking about. He reveals that he had worked with her father and that they arrested the cult together. The members had guns, and her father was being killed in the ensuing crossfire. He tells the rookie that if she needs any help, he will come over right away. The officer turns to leave, and the rookie sees that he has a bloody gash at the back of his head. She calls after him, but he disappears. Alone again, the rookie starts hearing and seeing various cult members running around the hallways. The homeless man starts banging on the cell door, begging to be let out. Behind him, the rookie sees three cult members hanging from the ceiling. The rookie convinces herself that what she sees isn't real and leaves the homeless man being trapped inside. The rookie hears people singing the same hymn again, and she follows the sound. She comes across several girls seated in a circle and singing. They turn around, and they have bloodied hormone bag-like pillowcases over their heads. The door slams shut, and the vision disappears. The rookie discovers that the evidence from the cult case litters the floor inside the room. She hurriedly calls the sergeant and tells him about the visions. She thinks she cannot do this any longer, but the sergeant reprimands her and tells her to get herself together because she still wants to have a career tomorrow. The girl calls again to tell her that she escapes and that she is in Carmichael Road. The rookie is about to call the station when the girl tells her that the cult members are close. The call disconnects again. Calling the dispatcher again, the rookie learns that the girl she speaks with had passed away almost a year earlier than she had first thought. In fact, she is one of the last victims of the cult, and that she is beaten to death with a baseball bat. The dispatcher also tells her that they moved to the new station because there have been ghostly sightings and unexplained occurrences happening since the cult members killed themselves. The rookie ends the call when she notices crime scene pictures of her dead father, the officer, and the female followers strewn all over the hallway. The rookie collapses due to the great horror. Eventually, she gets up and sees a brunette woman walking down the hallway. The woman knocks the rookie out and drags her inside an interrogation room. It turns out that she is one of the remaining members of the cult. She asks the rookie if she has seen the cult leader tonight. She adds that it's also the first anniversary of the cult member's death. The brunette woman tells her that she is here to celebrate the anniversary. Then, she kills herself with the rookie's gun. Being shocked, the rookie yanks the gun from the woman's corpse and leaves the room. She finds the phone ringing once again. The girl pleads for help, but the rookie tells her that she knows the real girl has been dead for a year already. The voice at the other end of the line suddenly laughs, and the rookie feels something banging under her desk. She looks and sees a girl with a bashed-up face hiding under. Terrified, she runs her ass toward the shelves behind her. The girl follows her. The rookie can hear the girl's bones audibly crunching every time she moves, as if they are all broken. She also has the same voice as the one the rookie is talking to on the phone. She whispers that she doesn't want to die. Judging from the bashed-up face and the broken bones, this is the ghost of one of the cult's victims. The rookie squeezes her eyes shut until the girl disappears. She runs for the front door and discovers that it's locked. She pulls out her gun and shoots the glass door, but is shocked to see that it doesn't break. Her mobile phone rings, and she hears her father's voice. He urges her to stand her ground and avenge his death. The rookie sees the homeless man walking around. She handcuffs him again and turns him over to see that his face is all bloody and his eyes are protruding. The lights turn off and the man disappears. She runs to the holding cell, where she keeps the homeless man. She sees that he hangs himself, and the words, "The King of Hell," are being scrawled all over the walls in blood. The same song begins to blare from her radio, and blood pours out of it too. She turns around and sees a cult member shrieking at her, and the door slams shut, locking her inside. A projector screen now depicts the cult member's last moment. They put on pillowcases with pentagrams written on them with blood. On screen, the cult leader takes off his big-sized hormone bag to reveal his nasty, demon-like face. The rookie runs, and she sees the officer again. He smiles, and then a gunshot sounds, and blood gushes out of his mouth. The rookie's mobile phone rings, and she answers. Her father warns her that they're coming for her, and she has to stop them. The rookie braces herself and gathers her resolve. She hears a sound from the other end of the hallway and rushes to it. She sees three armed men with matching hormone bags on their heads, rather than on their smelly sausages. Without hesitation, she aims and fires. The men taunt her and tell her that she's going to die. The rookie chases them all around the station as the men preach about their cult's dark beliefs. She shoots them one by one. As she fires off the last shot, the sergeant steps behind her and shoots her too. The rookie is seriously wounded, and she asks the sergeant why he shot her. The movie ends with the revelation that the rookie is shocked to realize that there are no armed cult members attacking her. It is really the hazmat team who enters the building, and she exactly kills them all under hallucination. Slowly dying, the rookie realizes what she has done and tries to explain to the sergeant that what she sees is different. She resigns to her fate and starts singing the same song the cult members are singing. The rookie sees the three cult members approaching her and holding a big-sized hormone bag and a rope. This is Daniel CC Movie Channel. Stay safe and enjoy your day.